Assalamu alaikum, dear students. I am here in front of you with a new lecture of your course Semiconductor Electronic Devices. As you know that we are discussing bipolar junction transistor, and today we will discuss its fabrication. The first transistor was invented by Bardeen and Bratton in 1947. In this device, two sharp metal wires or cat's whiskers formed an ammeter of carriers and collector of carriers. These wires were simply pressed onto a slab of germanium, which provided a base or mechanical support through which the injected carriers flowed. The basic invention rapidly led to the BJT, in which charge injection and collection was achieved using two PN junctions in proximity to each other. The PN junctions in BJT can be formed in a variety of ways, using thermal diffusion, but in modern devices, ion implantation method is used. Initially known as the junction transistor, it does not become practical until the early 1950s. The term bipolar was tacked onto the name to distinguish the fact that both carrier types play important roles in the operation. Field effect transistors are unipolar transistors since their operation depends primarily on single carrier type. And we have discussed field effect transistor in detail in chapter number 6. Now, whenever there is a fabrication of device, it is very important to isolate it from its nearby device. So, we will discuss here isolation methods which are applied in the devices. The most significant advances in reducing overall device size and packing density have come from improved isolation methods. The traditional junction isolation technique requires the heavily doped P deep diffusion to align to the heavily doped and buried layer that is covered by thick epitaxial layer, and we will discuss about this in detail on the next slide. The area and the junction capacitance is determined by alignment tolerance, area of side diffusion, and allows for the split of depletion region. Modern isolation techniques involve oxide isolation and trench isolation. Now we will again come to our this figure, where initially we have taken the p-type substrate grown and heavily doped n-type layer which was buried inside, and then we have got grown lightly doped epitaxial layer. Then we will come to form a base. So, to produce a base, same step we have to repeat. First of all, it is oxidized, windows are defined using photolithography and etched in the oxide, and then using the photoresist and oxide, and as implant mask, an acceptor with such as boron was implanted into open window to form a p-type layer which will act as base. Then come the emitter. Then emitter diffusion will take place by repeating against the same step and by defining a window through which we have implanted a heavily doped anti-material such as arsenic or antimony, which will form the emitter. And when we have obtained both the emitter, the base, and the collector which was deep buried inside, then we will do the etching of this whole device, and then we will attach the metal contacts to just apply to any electrical circuit. Basically, when a device is ready, an oxide layer is deposited by CVD, windows are etched into it corresponding to emitter, base, collector contacts, and a suitable metal contact such as aluminium is sputter deposited to form ohmic contact. The aluminium is patterned photolithography using the interconnect mask and etched using reactive ion etching. The many ICs that are made simultaneously on the wafer are then separated into individual dies by sighing mounted on suitable packages, and various contacts are wire bonded to the external lead of the package. Now, what is the advanced BJT structure? The original BJT structure survived practically unchanged since the mid-60s. As the advances in the metal oxide semiconductor development appear, some of the fabrication technology are also applied to the BJT, such as low defect epitaxy, ion implant, plasma etching, local oxidation of silicon, polished silicon layer, improved lithography. As we have discussed earlier, that is, when a device is ready, then there is isolation is required between one device to the other, and such isolation is achieved by oxide and trench isolation. Oxide isolation processes were introduced in the late 70s. They utilize wet anisotropic etch potassium hydroxide of the 100 silicon wafer with silicon nitride as mask. The potassium hydroxide etch will erode the 1-1 plane, and oxide is either deposited or grown to fill the V grooves. To further reduce the area, trench isolation can be used, making use of trenched etching. The trench is typically 2 micrometer wide and 5 micrometer deep. The trench walls are oxidized and the remaining volume is filled with polysilicon. Now, this is our figure number 7.5, which shows the double polycrystalline self-aligned NPN BJTs, and its process is same as we have discussed earlier, except this is a double polysilicon self-aligned NPN BJT. In this BJT, as shown in A, basically, first of all, P-type substrate is taken and a heavily N type buried layer is formed by using arsenic or antimony? And then there on its top, there is an epitaxy followed by the isolation produced. Then, as we have discussed in previous two, three slides, then come their base emitter window definition and optional mass sinker implant. So, a polysilicon layer is deposited by low pressure chemical vapor deposition and doped heavily with p-type material using boron during deposition or subsequently by ion implantation. Then an oxide layer is deposited next by LPCD using photolithography with base emitter mask. A window is etched in the polysilicon oxide stack by reactive ion etching. A heavily doped extrinsic base is formed by diffusion of boron from doped polysilicon layer into the substrate in order to provide a low resistance. High speed base ohmic contact. An oxide layer is then deposited by a low pressure chemical vapor deposition, which has the effect of closing up the base window that was etched previously and the boron was implanted in the window. This base implant forms a more lightly p-doped intrinsic base through which most of current flows from emitter to collector, and this is shown in figure 7.5D. The more heavily doped extrinsic base forms a collar around the intrinsic base and serves to reduce the base series resistance. It is critical that base be enclosed well within the collector, because otherwise it could be short-circuited the P substrate. Finally, another low pressure seaweed oxide layer is deposited to close up the base window further, and oxide is etched all the way to the silicon substrate by reactive ion etching, leaving oxide spacer on the side walls. Heavily endoped polysilicon, preferably by using arsenic, and is then deposited on the substrate, patterned and etched, forming polysilicon emitter and collector contact as shown in figure 7.5E. The use of two low pressure CVD polysilicon layers explain why this process is referred to as double polysilicon process. Arsenic from the polysilicon is diffused in the substrate to form the N plus emitter region nested within the base in a self-aligned manner, as well as the heavily doped N collector contact. Self-alignment refers to the fact that separate lithography step is not required to form the heavily doped emitter region. We cleverly made use of oxide sidewall spacer to ensure the heavily doped emitter region lies within the intrinsic p-type base. This is critical because otherwise the ammeter gets shorted to the collector. We also want a gap between the heavily doped ammeter and heavily doped p-type extrinsic base, because otherwise the base ammeter junction capacitance becomes too high. In the vertical direction, the difference between the ammeter base junction and base collector junction determine the base width. This is made very narrow in high gain, high speed BJTs. So this is how our BJT is fabricated. Now students, if this figure looks complicated to you, then don't worry, because I have started with a very simple figure and then addressed everything one by one. Still, if you have some question to ask, you are welcome to ask. You can contact with me in your Google class, or you can add any comment to today's lecture in the YouTube. But I will ask few questions from you to assess that whether you have understood my lecture or not in my Google class. Nice to see you again, and inshallah ta'ala, I will come again with another lecture tomorrow.